Incarnation is our very being. It's hard to imagine a scenario where humans could survive long hibernation periods in a deep slumber lasting hundreds or even thousands of years. If we were preserved in a frozen state, for example, could we be thought out and go on to live in some capacity for a very long time? To achieve this today, we would have to be alive to begin with and in good health. Our bodies survive coma states for years but break down very easily. If it is possible for our entire being to be frozen and reanimated, it is entirely unclear if the consciousness of the person that occupies said body would survive this process. The reason we are saying this, guys, is because of a dramatic find in the permafrost of Siberia that has the scientific community the world over at a standstill. Wait till you hear this. According to University of Tennessee microbiologist Tatiana Veshnitskaya's, as the permafrost melted away from these tiny worms, they sprang back to life after being frozen for over 40,000 years. The significance of the discovery has reverberated across the Earth, for if these tiny life forms can survive after being frozen suddenly as the extreme conditions overwhelmed the land, then maybe, just maybe, there are these types of life forms suspended in animation on other worlds across the universe. Against all the odds, these things have survived unsurvivable conditions, blowing the doors wide open on our understanding as to how life works. Researchers are discovering organisms frozen and presumed dead for millennia that can bear life anew. These Ice Age zombies range from simple bacteria to multicellular animals, and their endurance is prompting scientists to revise their understanding of what it means to survive. It does, in a way, remind us of the process of mummification and the placing of the mummy into a sarcophagus, especially in Egypt. Now, get this. This practice is a way to reach the afterlife, seriously suggesting, in our minds anyway, that these people witnessed the leaving of beings from the Earth to space in capsules, and they were special materials inside the capsule for the journey, possibly in suspended animation of sorts. These rituals and their symbols were largely derived from the cult of Osiris, who had already become a popular god. Osiris and his sister wife, Isis, were the first rulers of Egypt, given the land shortly after the creation of the world. They ruled over a kingdom of peace and tranquility, teaching the people the arts of agriculture, civilization, and granting men and women equal rights to live together in balance and harmony. Osiris's brother Set grew jealous of his brother's power and success, however, and so murdered him, first by sealing him in a coffin and sending him down the Nile River, and then by hacking his body into pieces and scattering them across Egypt. Isis retrieved Osiris's parts, reassembled him, and then with the help of her sister Nephthys, brought him back to life. Osiris was incomplete. He was missing his manhood, which had been eaten by a fish, and so could no longer rule on Earth. He descended to the underworld, where he became Lord of the Dead. Prior to his departure, Isis had mated with him and bore him a son, Horus, who would grow up to avenge his father, reclaim the kingdom, and again establish order and balance in the land. This recorded piece of history became so incredibly popular that it infused the culture and assimilated earlier gods and myths to create a central belief in a life after death and the possibility of resurrection in the future. Something that may be a real possibility and something the ancients seemingly knew about. Also, guys, a major discovery emerging from the time of the ancient Greeks is being reported in the Independence as a pyramid-shaped island complex rising from the sea. Atlantis springs to mind when considering this place, and it is dating back over 5,000 years. The site may also have been a part of the inspiration for a key aspect of Greek religion, and that being the idea that mountaintops were the dwelling places of the gods. What artifacts and treasures are just waiting to be found in and around this place may rewrite history as we know it. And the complex, which is on a mountain peak-shaped islet off the coast of the Aegean island of Keros, is totally changing archaeologists' understanding of the history of ancient Greece and indeed the world. It would seem that nobody had realized the true scale of the complex and the gargantuan effort that had gone into constructing it. Archaeologists at the site now believe that in order to construct the complex, early Bronze Age Greeks embarked on at least 3,500 voyages to transport over an astonishing 10,000 tons of shiny white marble from one Aegean island to another. Each return voyage would have required up to 24 crew members to paddle for around 5 hours. It is by far the largest prehistoric marine transport operation that has ever come to light anywhere in the world. Dr. Julian Whitewright, a leading maritime archaeologist at the University of Southampton, states, "It demonstrates quite clearly how important and integral to their culture seafaring was to these early Bronze Age Aegean people." The voyages, which are totaling around 45,000 miles, allow the architects to construct what is thought to have been a huge religious sanctuary consisting of up to 60 marble buildings, which were constructed specifically to glisten in the sun. What's more, the architects terraformed the pyramid-shaped island, a sort of mini-mountain, to create around 1,000 meters of artificial terracing arranged in 6 steps on its steep slopes. A true engineering marvel, and would be assumed as an architectural masterpiece. The roughly 6-meter-wide terraces appear to have been built specifically to accommodate all the buildings. The summit itself was not initially built on, but instead had a small, probably sacred, open area where votive offerings may have been deposited. The project's co-director, Michael Boyd of Cambridge University's MacDonald Institute for Archaeological Research, states, "Our investigation has been transforming our understanding of early Bronze Age Cycladic culture and suggests that these very early Greeks were organizationally, technically, and politically much more advanced than previously thought." Nothing like this monumental complex has ever been found from this period in or around Greece before. Intriguingly, it was built within 100 years or so of the creation of Stonehenge, the emergence of the dynastic Egyptians, and the first known Mesopotamian kingdoms. This broader context shows quite clearly this was part of a much wider cultural and political phenomenon involving huge, ultra-ambitious construction and political projects. These Egyptian, Mesopotamian, Indus Valley, and Central and South American traditions were almost certainly directly related to each other and were probably the result of a common stimulus, namely the spread of intensification of either early discoveries of the ancient things, including metal and material usage, as well as cultural and political changes this process triggered. From the south, the island would have been visible from many miles away as a gleaming white pyramid-shaped mini-mountain rising out of the sea. It is not known for sure whether the pyramid shape was in any way significant to the Greeks, as it was to the dynastic and indeed the ancient Egyptians. In the ancient Egyptian context, pyramid shapes were associated with a god of creation, Atum. He was believed to inhabit a pyramid-shaped rock, a pyramidion or Benben stone, that was seen as symbolizing the mythical primordial mound, representing the first dry land, which, much as in the book of Genesis, rose out of a chaotic sea at the time of creation. What's more, the pyramidic stone symbolized the sacred place where the first rays of the sun illuminated the primordial mound at the time of creation, and the pyramidic shape of the pyramidion was seen as symbolizing the slanting rays of the sun as they descended from the sky to earth. Indeed, the ancient Egyptians used to cover the symbolic pyramidions in gold leaf so they would shine and glisten in the sun. The Mesopotamians and others had similar primordial mound rising out of watery chaos creation myths, and it is conceivable that this islet rising out of the sea symbolizes some cycladic version of those wider sacred documented events. These finds are currently being investigated in great detail. Of particular interest are 1,500 imported stone discs and 700 imported white pebbles. The latter objects appear to have been used as religious offerings, presumably for the spirit or deity associated with the island Mini Mountain. But whether the pyramid-shaped islet was simply a spectacular religious sanctuary, or whether it also potentially symbolized the emergence of the first land out of the waters of chaos at creation, may never be known. Anywho, just a few topics of interest for you today, and we would also like to mention that we will be uploading to our secondary channel, Light Up the Dark, over the next few weeks, so please make sure you are subscribed so you don't miss any parts of our Anunnaki series. And also please check out our Patreon page, where we are offering the official mug to any of our would-be supporters. We will provide those links below. That's all for the moment from us, guys. Comments below, and as always, thank you for watching.